Okay, so first, I would like to thank the organizer for this night workshop and for giving me the opportunity to present my work. And I hope that this will not be a catastrophe. So, I will begin by a little introduction about exit problem. So I begin nicely. I consider a stochastic process XT, type for T larger or equal to zero. It can be a diffusion, and in my case, it's always a diffusion. It can be a jump process. It can be a piecewise deterministic Markov process. It can be anything. So I have a domain G, which is included in RK. I have a point x0 in this domain G, and the stochastic process begins at x0. And we wonder when it will exit from G. So the question, we define the exit time like so, tau xg is the first time that xt is not on G anymore. And the aim of the game is to answer to two questions. First, the exit time. What is tau xg? And secondly, the exit location. What is the place where we exit? The natural question, for example, if we consider a jump process, will be, will we exit on the boundary of G? And I don't know a lot about jump process, but I know that for some jump process, we exit with probability 1 to the boundary, which is to me quite unnatural, but and I would not be able to explain it, but I just find this funny, so I mention it. So now I will make a little, I will talk a bit about the Friedlin-Wenzel theory because my work is based on Friedlin-Wenzel theory. One considers first the stochastic process, xt epsilon, which is equal to x0, plus square root of epsilon beta t, where beta t is the Brownian motion, minus integral from 0 to t of the gradient of a potential u at xs epsilon ds. I will say after the hypothesis that I put on the potential u. And we also consider psi t of x, which is x, minus integral from 0 to t of the gradient of u, psi s of x, ds. So it is exactly the same process, except that there is no diffusion. Epsilon is equal to 0. Now the hypothesis that I put on the potentials, I assume that u is uniformly, strictly convex. So in Friedlin-Wenzel theory, we do not need at all this hypothesis. Just for this talk, since I consider everything in the convex case, I present it when u is convex, which simplifies the hypothesis on the domain for applying the Friedlin-Wenzel theory. I also assume that the minimum of u is at zero, and that this minimum is equal to zero. Yes, and x0 is an RK. And of course, K can be any value. And not in this talk, but in a previous talk, in the one which has been catastrophic, I make with K which goes to infinity, because I consider the exit problem of a system of particles. But here, I will not consider this. So we have a first lemma. No, u of 0 is 0. And u of x0 is, I don't know. A priori, yes. I mean, in fact, I don't assume anything on the domain G. I will discuss a bit about why we have to assume the stability by the potential. I will discuss it. We have a first lemma. And I don't want to make any mistake. Yes. For all t positive, the limit when epsilon goes to zero of the of the expectation of the supremum and zero t of x t epsilon minus psi t of x zero, which means that I consider the deterministic path which begins at x0, like the stochastic process, this is equal to 0. So this gives us a first nice result, which explains us why we have to assume some hypotheses on the domain. So I consider the domain. G. Included in RK. I consider the point x0, and I consider the deterministic path psi t of x0, and this is until psi large t of x0, and this is telling us that the stochastic process stays close to the deterministic path. Yes? Okay, sorry. So we can see that the stochastic process stays close to the deterministic path. So here I choose a deterministic path which does not exceed the domain G. So in fact, with high probability, the stochastic process does not exceed the domain G before T. So what we have is that T is less than tau of X epsilon G. But of course, here, I choose a deterministic path which does not exit from the domain G. I could have chosen a deterministic path which exits. So for example, I consider this domain, G, in RK. I consider X0 here. I consider 0 here. The deterministic path will go like so. I mean, not necessary, but it has the right to go like so. Psi t of x0. So here there is a point t such that psi t of x0 does not belong to g. So with high probability, the stochastic process will exit before t. So if we consider a domain where the stochastic path exits, we know that the exit problem will be related to the exit time of the deterministic path. So all the work is done, so it is easy. Now, if we consider a domain like so, the deterministic path will not exit, but the stochastic process, he has the right to exit because he has a Brownian diffusion and Brownian are crazy. So he will exit at a moment, but we cannot solve it directly. So we have to work a bit, and I will not do this work, but I will put the hypothesis. I call this the hypothesis that I call the stability. I think the real name is current positively invariant, something like this, if I am not wrong. Hypothesis. G is stable by U if and only if, I mean if, it's a definition, if for all t positive, for all x in G, psi t of x belongs to G. So in fact, one could tell me that there is not a mistake, but that this hypothesis is too strong. One could tell me that, in fact, what we need is the deterministic path which starts from x0 to b on the domain. Not necessarily all the deterministic paths. But in fact, what happens in this nice case where there is no self-stabilization is that this crazy Brownian will bring our stochastic path to some point, to any point in the domain. And we have if the deterministic path starting from any point of the domain exits from the domain, all remains to study the exit the heating time of of this point where the deterministic path exits from the domain. So we assume this Rolle hypothesis. But what we will see is for self-stabilizing process, we do not need exactly this hypothesis for the two potentials. Everything will be just a little flash forward. I will come back to this later. And now there is the proposition. I mean, the proposition is more a theorem, but proposition. So for a proof, one can see the book of Dembo and Zetouni. I like the book of Dembo and Zetouni, but of course it's also in the Friedlin-Wenzel in 98. But me, I prefer the book of Dembo and Zetouni. This is why I put this reference first. We assume that G is stable by U. Then we have two results. First of all, for all delta strictly positive, the limit when epsilon goes to zero of the probability of the exit time of x epsilon from G to be less than exponential of 2 over epsilon h plus delta and to be more than exponential of 2 over epsilon h minus delta, this is equal to 1, where h is the exit cost, which is the infimum on the boundary of G of U. In fact, it is the infimum of U on the boundary of G minus U of 0. But here I choose U of 0 equal to 0. So this is a first result which tells us the distribution about the exit time. So we have solved the exit time. Now there is the problem of the exit location. So everything is related to this exit cost. So in fact, natural question, when you have to go somewhere, do you choose the path which is the more expensive or the most expensive or the path which is the least expensive, the less expensive? Me, I choose the path which is the less expensive, and the Brownian motion does the same. For all n, which is included in the boundary of G, such that the infimum over n of u is strictly more than h, the limit when epsilon goes to 0 of the probability of x epsilon tau x epsilon g to belongs to n, this is equal to zero. In other words, if the exit cost from some part of the boundary is strictly more than the exit cost of the boundary, this does not see the exit of the process. We exit somewhere else. So this was a little introduction about the exit problem on all the theory which I am based on. Now I will talk about my model, which is a self-stabilizing diffusion. So, second part, the model. Little a, self-stabilizing diffusion. So, the exact hypothesis, okay. So I will not consider the general model. I will only consider some restricted model, which is simpler and which contains all the mathematical difficulties, because I could present in a general way, but I don't think that it is good to discover anything by an atypical example. So I present the typical example. So first of all, I take x0 in Rd, and I consider xt, which is equal to x0 plus square root of epsilon bt1. So this Brownian motion, I put the index 1 because I will consider a lot of Brownian motion in the little b of this second part, minus integral from 0 to t of gradient of v of xs ds minus integral from 0 to t of gradient of f, convolution with mu s, xs ds, where mu t is the onlaw of the process xt. So this is the McKinley-Vlasov diffusion, and which is related to what Upanchu presented us and to the work of, I don't know how to pronounce it. Yes. Dong. Okay. So here, as potential, I take V, which is uniformly, strictly convex. And in fact, it is kind of a scam because to solve the exit problem of the self-stabilizing process in the convex case, it has been solved, this has been done something like 9 years ago, and I am presenting it. In fact, I will present a new proof of this statement. And as the interacting potential F, I choose the simplest one, alpha over 2, x power 2. Where alpha is strictly positive, because if alpha is negative, it will be a bit more complex. So this kind of process comes from when we take the hydrodynamic limit of a system of particles. So let us see the associated system of particles. Here we consider ZTI, which is equal to X0I, where X0I is a sequence of independent and identically distributed random variables, which have the same laws than X0, plus square root of epsilon BTI. So it is exactly BT1 when I is equal to 1. So the first particle in this system has the same Brennan motion as our self-stabilizing diffusion. I assume that all the Brennan motion are independent, that they are also independent from the initial random variables. And what I have is minus integral from 0 to t of gradient of v of zsi ds. So this does not change. This is a confining potential. This does not change. Confining potential is nice. And now the interacting potential, it's minus 1 over n, sum for j equal 1 to n of the integral from 0 to t of the gradient of f zsi minus zsj ds, where n is something which is large. A priori, n goes to infinity. So here, what we can remark is that this, in fact, it is the integral from 0 to t of the gradient of f that we take the convolution with the empirical measure, 1 over n, sum for j equal 1 to n, of delta in ZSJ taken at ZSI. And intuitively, for justifying why this is associated to the self-stabilizing diffusion, what we remark is that the force of the particle J on the particle I is divided by N. So when n goes to infinity, intuitively, the force that j exerts on I goes to zero. So the two particles become independent. So this empirical measure will converge to the law of ZTI, and we find the self-stabilizing diffusion. Of course, this statement is not totally true. Because, in fact, here I should have written that ZSI and ZSJ do depend on N. But this is a real result that I will give. Proposition. So, for a proof, one can see the article of Benachour, Rouanet, Talley, and Valois in 98. And for the other statement that I will give, one can see Catio, Guillain, and Malrieu in 2008. Except that Catio, Guillain, and Malrieu did this with a potential which is non-uniformly strictly convex, but just convex. So it is more difficult. So first, for all t positive, the limit when n goes to infinity of the expectation of the supremum over 0 t of xt minus zt1 square, this is equal to 0. So in fact, we have the path of the first particle in the mean field system of particles. This is very close to the path of the self-stabilizing diffusion. But the problem is that it is only for t, which is finite. But, okay, we have another result, which tells us that limit when n goes to infinity of the supremum for t positive of the expectation of xt minus zt1 square, this goes to zero. Here we have succeeded to remove the dependency in time with some t. But the only problem is that the supremum is not inside of the expectation. So it is not so interesting, in fact. And here, we really need the convexity of the potential. Yes? It is just the first one. I take just the first one. Yes, it's a one. No problem. And in fact, the uniform propagation of chaos in a non-convex case is much more difficult. And there is an article which will probably be published in Les Annales de l'Institut Henri Poincaré from Pierre Delmoral and myself. But this is not the subject. So we can also relate the self-stabilizing diffusion to granular media equation. So first of all, for all t positive, mu t is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure. I denote its density ut. Then we have the following. Partial differential equation. D over dt of u is equal to d over dx of epsilon over 2 du over dx plus u multiplied by gradient of v plus gradient of f convolution with u. So one can study the long-time behavior of the self-stabilizing diffusion by using the partial differential equation. Or conversely, one can study the partial differential equation by using the self-stabilizing diffusion and its associated system of particles. And now I will give some results about the exit problem. Finally, so proposition. So it's a work of Hermann, Imkeller, and Petman in 2008 in Annals of Applied Probability. So this is the exact hypothesis. I assume that the domain D, because now the domain that I consider is denoted by D, D it was for the general case, D is stable by V. I also assume that D is stable by V plus F convolution with the Dirac measure in zero, which is equal to V plus F. But I insist on this Dirac measure on zero because this is just because I chose the minimum of the well, the minimum of the potential to be at zero. If it was in X zero, this would be F convolution with delta in X zero. So this is very important. Then what we have, then what we have, like this, is that for all delta strictly positive, the limit when epsilon goes to zero of the probability for the exit problem of the diffusion X from the domain D to be less than exponential of 2 over epsilon H hat plus delta, and to be more than exponential of 2 over epsilon h hat minus delta, this is equal to 1. Where h hat is equal to the infimum of the boundary of D of V plus F. And here again, normally it is the infimum of D of the boundary of D of V plus F convolution with delta in x0 minus V of x0 plus F of x0 minus x0, which is 0. And as a result, for all n, including in the boundary of D, which is such that the infimum over n of V plus F is strictly more than H hat, then it does not see the exit. The limit when epsilon goes to 0 of the probability of x tau xj to belongs to n, this is equal to 0. So I will not present you any more result. This was the only result that I wanted to present. This result is, to me, is very nice. But the only problem is that here V has to be convex. And Samuel Hermann, who is one of the authors, told me that they tried to do the non-convex case, but that they completely broke their teeth. And he told me that I had 1 year, I was beginning my PhD, that I had 1 year to solve the non-convex case. It was in 2006. Now we are in 2015. And if I would be able to present the non-convex case, I would do so. So maybe I'm very bad, but I still don't have finished the first thing that he wanted to do, that he wanted me to do as a PhD student. Whatever, what I succeeded to do is to give another proof, but first I will present a bit their proof. So how did they process? They just reconstruct the Friedlin-Wenzel theory. And they adapted it to self-stabilizing diffusion. And at the moment, they need the convexity, and they were forced to put this hypothesis of convexity. And me, I saw this result of uniform propagation of chaos from Catteau-Guilland-Malrieu, and I reflected. I was thinking, maybe I can find another proof which would be much simpler, much intuitive. And in fine, I have been quite lucky because, you will see. But I have been quite lucky by thinking that I could find another better proof. So theorem. So for a proof, for the exact proof, one can see the article published in Electronic Journal of Probability. So here, I change a bit the result. I don't assume that D is stable by V. I just assume that psi t of x0 belongs to D for all t positive. In other words, I don't assume the stability starting from all the points, just starting from the point x0. I still assume that D is stable by V plus F. Then, the first point and the second point of the previous result hold. And I will present you a bit the method that I used for making this proof. You will see it's very intuitive, but totally intuitive. What I say is the following. Well, according to the result of Catteau-Guilland-Malrieu, x and z1 are almost the same. So tau of xd, it's kind of tau of z1 d. Yeah, it seems quite great. After, tau of z1 d, it is exactly tau of z1, zn from the domain d times rd power n minus 1. And after, I just have to apply the Friedlin-Wenzel theory, the Friedlin-Wenzel result, to this new exit time, tau of z1, zn, leaving d times rd power n minus 1. And why I am very lucky is because if I had reflected a bit more before of writing the article, I would have seen that this is wrong, because we would need the supremum to be inside of the expectation, so this does not work. This works, because this is just a rewriting, so this is really not difficult. And we cannot apply Friedlin-Wenzel theory to this. Ah, nothing works. But finally, I have been lucky. Because in fact, the problem is that d times rd power n minus 1, this is not stable by the potential which is underlying in the associated system of particles. So what I need to do, and it is a bit more technical, which was not the idea, because I wanted to do something which is intuitive and less technical, because I found their proof quite technical. In fine, my proof is much more technical than their proof. What I do is that I succeeded to prove that tau of xd is kind of tau of z1d when epsilon is very small. This is not totally wrong. This statement is true. Tau of z1d, it's exactly tau of z1 zn leaving d times rd power n minus 1. And now, tau of z1 zn d times rd power n minus 1. So this is a technical thing. I will not enter more in the details than this. This is almost tau of z1 zn leaving d times rd power n minus 1 intersection with the ball of radius kappa and of center 0 in dimension n. Yes, it's in dimension nd. It's in dimension nd. Then I have to assume that d is stable by v plus f convolution with mu for all mu which is in this ball. In fact, it's the ball. Yes. Kappa is something small. It's another parameter which has to be small. Because we can enter in the ball of radius kappa quite fast. And after, we will leave after a large time in n. So we have to take kappa small, epsilon small, and n large. And we have to deal with these three parameters, which makes the proof quite technical. Yes. Because this domain is not stable, but d, if we are in this ball, v plus f convolution with mu will be the drift underlying, and this will be this will stay in d. It's the most technical part of this proof. And in fact, I will not annoy you more with this proof, because the 7th of October of 2014, I found another proof of the same result. And this proof is also intuitive, but it's less technical. So this is what I want to present you today. So first of all, how do I show that tau xd is close to tau z1d? For showing this, what I remark is that v plus f convolution with mu t is close to v plus f. And the drift of the associated particles is also closed to v plus f. So since they are closed to v plus, since both of them are closed to v plus f, the two drifts are closed together. But why doing so? It's quite stupid, because if it is closed to v plus f, instead of considering this very hard problem of associated system of particles, one could directly consider the diffusion with drift v plus f. So let us see the other proof. My last proof on this subject. Other proof. So it is for the moment just a draft, but I like a lot this proof. So first of all, we need to control the moments. We have this proposition. Which is that the supremum for t positive of the expectation of x t power 2. This is less than the maximum between x 0 power 2 and epsilon over 2 theta power 2. We also have that for all epsilon positive, for all kappa positive, by putting t kappa of epsilon, the first time deterministic, such that the expectation of xt, square is less than kappa square, then for all epsilon more than theta kappa square, t kappa of epsilon is less than x0 power 2 over theta kappa square. And for all t, which is more than t kappa epsilon, the expectation of xt power 2 is less than kappa square. So this is kind of technical. Ah, yes. So this is a bit technical, but in fact, what does that mean? That just means, first, that we have a control of the moments. It is bounded by x0 square and by something which just depends on epsilon. And secondly, the first time for being small, for having a small expectation of the xt power 2, it's a time which is easy to control. And after this time, the expectation will always be kappa less than kappa square for all kappa positive. And of course, I take kappa which is small. So I will give some element of the proof because I want to prove something. I take psi t which is equal to the expectation of xt power 2. First, I apply Itô formula, then I integrate, then I take the expectation, and then I take the derivative. It gives us c prime of t, which is equal to minus expectation of xt scalar product with gradient v of xt, minus 2 expectation of xt gradient f convolution with mu t of xt. So this, it is positive. It is a classical thing to show that this is positive because, in fact, when we take the expectation here, what we have is the gradient f convolution with mu t. It's exactly the expectation of gradient f of something minus xt. So we have, in fact, xt gradient f of xt minus yt, where y is an independent copy of x. So this is a classical thing to show that it is positive, plus epsilon. And this, by using the property of uniform strict convexity, it is less than minus 2 theta psi t power 1 over 2 square root of psi t minus epsilon over 2 theta. And after, it is just some analysis to show that the supremum of psi t will be less than its first value. And this value, epsilon over 2 theta power 2. And to show that this deterministic time is controllable by x0 square divided by theta kappa 2, it's also some classical analysis. Now, what we have. Tk, it is the minimum so that the expectation is smaller than kappa square. It is the first time that it is smaller than kappa square. Because what will happen is that, what will happen is that after t kappa, the drift is almost v plus f. And before t kappa, we do not exit. Why? In fact, this is a little too probability of exiting before t kappa. In fact, we just apply the classical Friedlin-Wenzel result, and this tells us that the limit when epsilon goes to zero of the probability for tau xg d to be less than x0 power 2 divided by theta kappa power 2, this does not depend on epsilon, so this is equal to zero. So in particular, we have the limit when epsilon goes to zero of the probability for the exit time to be before t kappa of epsilon, this is equal to zero. And now we have the coupling result. Because like I said, the drift is almost v plus f. So